Right, Ewan, to be obtuse, is this Jim Goodwin's John Wayne summer?
I don't have the first idea what you're talking about.
He's gone for True Grit in his first two signings. Oh, boom, boom, I'm here all
dear,
week.
Oh, dear.
Right, well, I thought of that before it came in.
Yeah, you did think of that. You did think of that. Well, I suppose you make a point. That is True Grit. I mean, the first two signings are quite telling. We do always say your first signing in the close season is almost setting a template for what you're looking for, isn't it? And your first signing as a manager is setting a template for what you're looking at. And sometimes I know of this as a fact, that sometimes clubs will have signed two or three players at the same time, and they will intentionally put out the one that they want to showcase mm-hmm. as a style. So very first signing coming in, Ross Docherty, ex-Partick Thistle captain, very strong leader, very, very good, experienced championship player. Who will run all day. He scored a few goals last season. He worked in a very, very good Partick Thistle side that, as we know, suffered heartbreak in the playoffs. I think that's a fantastic first signing. I watched his interview and he spoke in length about how they need a team of leaders. It can't just be one leader on the pitch. They need a team of leaders. And I think he's got hit the nail on the head with that. And that's very much, as we spoke last week, he's a Jim Goodman-style player. So the Jim Goodwin we saw playing football.
I was going to say, you called him Goodwin, first of all. I'm glad Jim Goodwin, whoever he is, likes him. Does Jim Goodwin like him too?
Yeah. I'm sorry, I did say that. I was hoping you wouldn't notice that, or it would be edited out.
The only mistakes I don't notice are mine, and there's many of them.
Okay. And then we've obviously got Liam Grimshaw as well, who signed yesterday, and he looks mean. Let's say he looks mean in his photographs. And I think that's the style that Dundee United are going for, aren't they? They want players to look mean. They want players to look like they're going to be hard out in the pitch. They're going to be tough to shrug off the ball. They're going to go in hard on tackles. Because it was a criticism that was levelled quite mm-hmm. regularly towards that Dundee United team last season, that they lacked a dog in the midfield. To quote Jim Goodwin, they lacked a dog in the midfield. They lacked somebody to go and fight the ball. They lacked a Jando Fuchs with the energy in the outbits. They lacked a Callum Butcher style player. And clearly they have signed two players that have got the ability to do that. I know that Grimshaw can play either in defence or in midfield. I know that last season he won two Player of the Year awards at Morton and played every single game for them last season. He's played over 100 games for Motherwell. He started at Manchester United, came through the ranks there, didn't feature for Manchester United. So he's got a little bit of a pedigree. And also, interestingly enough, I noticed this morning he's got a blog, which is quite an interesting blog. It's a step away from football. He's writing about holiday.
Can he not afford the vlog?
No, he's still not upgraded to a blog. He's on a blog. But it's interesting. I mean, he's talking about holiday
destinations. I see you last week. I'm down with the kids now.
He's quite a good writer. He's good at writing. So
overrated profession, if you ask me.
So Dundee United have now got somebody that's an expert on a blog, and they've now got a vlog as well with Tony Watts, so the two of them can team up together. So,
they play?
Well, I don't know about that aspect yet. They'll be quite good on the media aspect now, though. I think these are two good, very good signings. And I think, again, it almost sings back to what we were saying last week. They need players that can help them get out of the Championship. Now, would they be players that they would have made their first two signs had they been going for top four in the Premiership? I'm not sure they would be. They might be. But they do need to sign players that know the league, that are going to fight, that are going to scrap for the ball, are going to be up for the challenge. And I think it's a very positive start by Jim Goodwin.
And he's done what he put on the tin, to paraphrase an advertising slogan. Bear. He said he mm-hmm. needed that type of player. I mean, it strikes me, not necessarily in defence of the players already there, you could label United last season in some ways a soft team. Mm-hmm. Individually, I would not say that about the players in terms of their attitude, but it was all down to the style, and that was the flaw in mm-hmm. the squad. There were a footballing squad almost entirely. You need the sort of Scott Brown style of player in there as well, and I think that's what they lacked, and maybe that's what he's added with these two, who can, no question, they can play a bit, mm-hmm. but when you need guys in the trenches, they're the ones that will step up first.
Yeah, I mean, I like Ross Docherty. I don't know so much about Liam Grimshaw, although I know him as a player. I've noticed Ross Docherty a bit more throughout yeah. his career, and Ewan's right, you know. he is the sort of player that you need in that division. He is a leader. I think he's a bit of a narc on the park. He won't let players rest. He's a bit of a Paul McGowan type, different type of player, but that sort of attitude in a game, you know, if somebody's not keeping the standards up, he won't be slow to let them know about it. He's always on the referee's case as well. And just a good all-round signing for Dundee United. Obviously, Grimshaw is very important. You made a good point there, Ewan, about the fact that he played most games last season. I think with the squad United they're going to have, it's important that they have most of them fit and ready to go. And you know, they've got a good history of playing games. They're going to need that as well. And the type of signings, we spoke about it last week, and Jim Goodwin had already spoken about what he's going to need, and he's done that straight away. You know, two guys for the league, they're in effectively. You know, and I think the good thing is as well, I spoke about this last week, what type of player can United expect to get? What type of, I know the ones the fans might want, but realistically, what type of player can United expect to get at this point in time in the transfer window? And I still believe that these two guys will see this as a step up in their careers coming to a club like Dundee United, and that's a great place to be. That's a great place to be. That you're not going to get a player coming and going.
Well, you've got two guys in the dressing room who are on a high because they've signed for a bigger club.
Absolutely. So that's a good thing as well. Like, you know, they'll feel they've obviously got something to prove to the fans when they get there, even though they have played a lot of games in the division. And well, signing them is good for Dundee United. It also weakens two of the opposition teams in that league.
Yeah, I was thinking that too.
So he's got a couple of players over the line. I'm sure there will be more. I think we might find one or two coming really late in the window. There's a lot of things going to happen at Dundee United over the next 3 or 4 weeks. Yeah. I would think in terms of comings and goings. But Jim Goodwin will be pleased to get a couple of players and a couple of good players at that.
I think you're right about the comings and goings. I think that was the first thing I thought when I saw those players. It might be the case that some players that are still at the club might now move on. So there will be comings and goings. But I would anticipate Dundee United are probably going to, and this is just off the top of my head, 4 to 5 more players potentially would come in, and then I don't know how many would go out, but I would anticipate there's going to be, for him to make a real impact and put a real imprint on his side, he's probably going to need that amount of players to come in and change things about.
And he needs the freshness. The club will still be, you know, as I've spoken about, there was a cloud hanging over Tardis which had to be lifted, and you do that by bringing in freshness. And it's difficult for Jim Goodwin because he has got a lot of players under contract, a lot of players under big contract there. How does he change things around? But he just has to find a way to do that, and this is the start of it. I'm not sure Dundee United back training yet, you know,
Thursday they were due back today, actually.
He'll be wanting the whole atmosphere. Last season is over. They're now looking ahead, so he'll be wanting that lifter, and they can do that with a lot of fresh faces as well.
It's good to have a couple of boys in for the first day of pre-season, because just the fact that they're getting introduced to everybody and speaking to guys they've maybe played against or played with in the past, it gives the place a wee bit of a buzz. Also, you get your business done, start getting your business done early. And everyone's got a limited budget these days. It's maybe worth, if you can get business done early, come the end of the transfer window, you might be left with enough for another sign-in. And simply because the later you go, and it's not just about transfer fees, if guys, it's professional sport. If guys know you really need them and time's running out before the end of the transfer window, they'll ask for more money.
Yeah. That's exactly it. And I can still see that happening at Canada.
I've seen it happen. I know one, I won't name names, but I can remember one Dundee United signing in particular in my time where we were invited up to meet him, and his agent found out we'd been invited up. And we're sitting there for 2 hours. Because the agent said to United, well, that's the press here. You don't want to sign him now. Can we get another £100 a week? He had United over a barrel.
Yeah, I'm sure these things.
I think Jim McLean had him over more than a barrel once it was done.
Yeah, I can imagine. But I can see that happening at Charlie's. But
Jim was chairman at the time, I should
more ask. More so by players who may hang off to leave. That's the issue Jim Goodwin is going to have. I'm sure he'd like to get a few of them out the door now, so he would have an idea how much more in his budget he will have to spend. But it may be the case it will be in August before some players move on.
But I suppose the other side, to move away from the monetary side is guys that are there, because a lot of players realise it's a limited career in terms of time. When they see the replacement's been signed, they want to go somewhere else rather than sit about for the next 11 months.
Yeah, I mean, I don't understand players. I mean, I do understand why players want to sit about town, because they're sitting getting...
If they're on good money and they've got mortgages to pay.
Exactly. And it's not them that had the contract thrust under their nose. They've signed the contract, and they've got to honour that contract. That's
100%.
That's exactly the way football works. But it doesn't help Jim Goodwin at this point in time in terms of building a new squad for next season, because that's what he needs to do. That's two in. You're right, Ewan. I think he needs half a dozen of those type players. And there might be a few others in that division that he's eyeing up as well at this point in time. You know, there are a few guys that are out of contract.
Who you two watched the Championship all last year? Who would you go for if you had to check?
To be honest, he's missed out on one that signed for Ross County yesterday. Kyle Turner would have been a stick one for me.
I'd heard Kilmarnock were wanting him as well.
Well, I thought he might even arrive in the city, even across the road, to be honest, with you, Dundee. Yeah. But Kyle Turner would have been ideal, and he would have been ideal alongside Ross Docherty.
He was mentioned at a few clubs. I'm just wondering if it's just what we've spoken about just a second ago, where the agent has gone, How much? And ultimately, it has been Ross County who have said, we'll pay that. Yeah. And that'll do for me, because it's a long way up to Dingwall from Glasgow.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah, so it's quite plausible that either or both of the Dundee teams had an interest in Kyle Turner, because he would have been the type of player who would have added to both midfield. So.
Yeah, I certainly think at United, I'm still to be convinced by Kyle Turner that, you know, at the top level. I think he still has to prove it himself that he could play at that sort of level, and hopefully he can do that next season. He's got an opportunity to do that. But
so you've heard it here first, who's not signing for Dundee United. That was not the question. You're like a pair of politicians. That was not the question. The question was, who would you go for?
I mean, is Kevin Holt still available? I mean,
he's freed. He's not freed. He's turned down a contract with Partick Thistle, so
I mean, that'd be an interesting one. If I don't know. I don't know if Kevin's Jim Goodwin type of player. Kevin is a good player, and he's played in the Premier League level and done well at left back, and he is a big lad as well. But he's not really an aggressive.
That was always the complaint at Dundee. Lovely lad and a lovely footballer. Yeah. To be fair, he moved into central defence for Thistle and did it.
Yeah,
I must admit, I don't want to sort of start a rumour or add to a rumour. It did cross my mind, given his age and given that thing that he's not the hardest player in the world, the fact that he's turned down a contract with Partick made me worry more for Partick that made me think that he had something big lined up.
Yeah.
Well, I think Partick has got real financial issues.
I think they do.
I knew Bear would sort of fire up the rumour.
Yeah, it's... I think it's tough for them, because they were within a whisker of being a Premier League
20 minutes away.
I feel for Chris Doolan, because he did a good job, and it's like they have signed a couple of players. I see the guy Aaron Muirhead signed to it. I think
he's a good player, decent
defender. But can he really do it again? Can he really compete again? I wouldn't bet against Chris Doolan, because I think he gets the best out of players, and that's what you've got to do sometimes. You've got to play with the hand you're dealt with, effectively. And he did really well last season. But it must be tough to see all these players who got them so close now. But that's always the case. The vultures will strike.
I go back to his professional sport. On a personal level, I feel for Partick Thistle, but on a level of wanting Dundee United to do what I'm tipping them to do and run away with that championship, the weaker they are, the better, as far as I'm concerned, because that is one of those grounds. Mm-hmm. I've mentioned Dunfermline and Greenock for Morton in the past, but Firhill's another ground where it's hard to go twice and take full points or even avoid a defeat.
And that's what Jim Goodwin touched on when he spoke last week. We've got to have guys who can go to Gayfield and get a result.
Yeah.
You know, in the conditions. We've got to have guys who can go up to Inverness in midweek and get a result in the conditions. And that really is what it's all about. But last season, you know, there wasn't many teams that were able to do that on a consistent basis. Nope. And that's why you could have thrown a tablecloth over, you know, or a
until Dundee raced away in the final 45 minutes.
Over half a dozen of teams, It was really sort of too close to call. And I don't think Dundee United want to get involved in that sort of thing. But, going back to Grimshaw, you know, and Ross Docherty, good signings, another couple required, and then we'll see who is going to be playing. I mean, there will be players who will remain at Tannadice, yeah. and it'll be up to Jim Goodwin to make sure the quality is there. He's got to get the attitude right with these guys, and if he can do that with, you know, a couple more additions, the quality that, you know, Dundee United will have will be better than anything else in that division, Tam. And it should just be a case of, you know, getting them playing week in, week out, and they should have enough to get themselves over the line.
There could be players that have come in from the cold storage that they weren't fancied under the three managers they had last season, and suddenly come into the reckoning. They've definitely got quality players and quality young players as well in that squad that could come in and make a difference. So
And going back to what you said about Ross Docherty talking about leaders, just that point he made about the style of the squad wasn't a battling squad. Having said that, you often find if you've got one or two battlers in your squad or in your team who are leaders, the others do follow. Mm-hmm. These guys that are silky players, you suddenly see them rolling up their sleeves, proverbially, whatever the word is, and joining the fight. And that's that. I mean, to me, Docherty and Grimshaw, that's what they can bring us. If they can influence those around them in that way, and then you get, and I think United fans, for all I'm tipping them, you know, to win this league reasonably comfortably, it's back to the thing that you always say, win your home games. If you're winning your home games, a point at Firhill, a point at Morton, a point in Inverness, they're good points.
You're talking about leaders there. I'll go back to that. The point about leadership, it doesn't necessarily fall that you have to be a hard man to be a leader.
No.
You can be a leader on the park by doing other things on the park, but yet obviously 100% commitment is one of the things that you're looking for. I'm thinking at the top of my head, I spoke about young players, I'm thinking Archie Meekison comes to mind, right? Now, Archie's not really had that regular run of games in that side under any of the managers, but I look at him as a player, and I think he's got leadership qualities, because whenever he was thrown onto the pitch, same with Kai Fotheringham, I would say that as well, when he was thrown, you could see that he was given absolutely everything he got, and he cared about it. I spoke to him quite a lot when I was at Dundee United, and he's a very articulate, very deep-thinking footballer as well that cares deeply about the game. I think this could be an opportunity for the likes of Archie Meekison to come in, particularly in the Championship as well, to take a regular game and show that he's got leadership qualities in a different sense, because he's not a hard man. He's not somebody that's going to go in and put a studded tackle in or barge somebody off the ball or anything like that. But he is somebody that's going to show leadership by going and giving that 100% commitment. And I think Kai Fotheringham, again, when he came in towards the end of the last season, he showed some leadership qualities, because he was willing to take the ball, he was willing to take chances, and he wasn't hiding in games, and I think that's an aspect as well. So I think there's probably leaders within their group of a different sense, and they can't have 11 hard men.
Yeah, I mean, the other end of the age scale, Stephen Fletcher
100%.
Might not put a tackle in over 90 minutes, but he'll put his head in where it hurts.
Yep.
He'll press defenders when they've got the ball. He'll give 100% every single game. And that encourages people to do their jobs. And if their job's putting tackles in and blocks in and stuff like that, they do it. And I think Stephen Fletcher will be invaluable to United as long as he's there.
I really hope he's one of the players that actually, you know, that stays on.
Yeah,
I mean,
there
are a few others that, you know,
because in the end, we can talk about all the attitude and effort in the world. If you've got his quality, you're going to be head and shoulders above
quality
most opposition
and experience
players.
And, you know, the nous to hold the ball and win penalty kicks, as we've seen in the. You saw defenders coming in the Premiership, you'll see them coming big style in the Championship.
Yeah.
And, you know, leadership qualities. You touched on it, Ewan, certainly with the young lads. Well, it's crisis for some, it's opportunity. Opportunity is the word for others, certainly for the young lads. This is it. Had United been the Premiership, it could be in our season of wait for your chance. They're going to get thrown in next season, and it's up to them to grasp that opportunity with both hands and then, you know, do well and make themselves undroppable, so that if the team goes back up, and hopefully they do, they are in that starting 11 for the Premiership, if not with Dundee United, with somebody else doing something in their career, you know, that they can really give them a lift off. It's a real platform for them. So I'd be excited if I was a youngster at Tannadice now, as the guys you've touched on, there's a few more as well.
Yep.
You know, I'd be excited. I'd be thinking, this is going to be my chance this season. I'm going to really, you know, take it with both hands.
Somebody like Logan Chalmers, for instance, has been, I mean, he was sent out on loan a few times last season, went to Air United, went to Tranmere, didn't quite stake his claim in the side, but I've noticed quite a number of Dundee United fans just reading comments online seem to be almost assuming that he will be back in the fold and he will be, because I think in the Championship he looked like a player. I think Air United fans would bite your hand off to take him back. So he's obviously got quality, did well at Inverness when he went on loan as well. Yeah. So I think he could be somebody that could actually benefit from the side being in the Championship as opposed to being in the Premiership.
I think the time has come for Logan to step up. I think he's really, I mean, there are a few other guys we've spoken about, Meekinson, still got a couple of years maybe on their side.
He loves putting pressure on young players, eh?
Well, I think Logan, is getting beyond that stage now. It's now time for him. Either at United or he's got to move somewhere else.
You reach a number of first team games where you can actually add in terms of where you should be a couple of years to your age, even if you're still 20, 21. Because you've played a lot, or been involved in the first team for long enough that now's the time to make your mark, and he's maybe one.
It's now or never, you're right. Spot on with that.
Anyway, in other news, Ryan Edwards has opened up, according to your note.
I never put broken his silence.
He's denied that the players threw Jack Ross under the bus. Was that just because there was only a taxi passing at the time, or did they back Jack Ross?
That was
a bit bitchy. Eh?
Yeah, well, I mean, I spoke to Ryan earlier this week, and I spoke to him for 45 minutes, and he opened up in quite a
whole half. That's a week's work for you.
Yeah, it's horrible transcribing 45 minutes of notes, or putting together 45 minutes of notes, but there you go. You're almost wanting to cut it and say, right, Ryan, I've got enough now, I need to go.
That's when you retire, that's what I did.
So he opened up in a whole number of issues. There were obviously a number of issues, and I think Ryan had and I described it as a rollercoaster of the emotions that he had during his 3 years at Dundee United, and I think he did, because, I mean, he went from coming in, staking his claim and becoming a regular inside in the first season to the second season really kicking on and really becoming a cult hero where the supporters, the supporters were singing about him, they had banners about him.
Spectacular goal at Hearts.
Hibs. Oh yeah, on Hibs as well, sorry. No, you did, you're right, they scored for him about four.
I knew it started with H and was in Edinburgh. I'm thinking of the low one at Tynecastle.
Yeah, what, that he kicked it from Leaf and it went in the net at Tynecastle? He did, you're right, also, he did score at Easter Road as well, so, his stock was really high. I mean, there was all sorts of talk, and he pointed this out on the phone. At one point, his partnership with Charlie McGrew was talked about as being one of the best defensive partnerships.
Because it was.
So he went from that to last season. Like every other Dundee United player, he didn't have a good season last season. He admits
it's
that himself.
Amazing how things can go wrong.
But he went to the stage where he was then singled out a little bit for criticism. So he was getting personal criticism through social media. And he was also talking about being dropped by Jim Goodwin at the end as well. So he was dropped twice, well, effectively twice by Jim Goodwin. He was dropped first of all after making mistakes against Aberdeen, and he held his hands up and said, look, I made mistakes, I accept that, you know. It's quite a big statement to drop your captain, but he did drop him. He then got a chance back in the side against Rangers and St Mirren. And I was at the St Mirren game, and I thought he performed quite well that day, and I was impressed. But he then found himself effectively dropped out the side again for the remainder of the season. I mean, he played a sum total of less than 90 minutes in the last eight games. So he didn't agree with that decision. So, but the throwing under the bus thing, that was another accusation that was levelled, not directly towards Ryan Edwards.
It was the senior players, wasn't it?
It was towards the senior players. And he was quite clear in his mind that he didn't think that was the case. He said that he held a number of meetings with senior players after the manager lost the job, said that we've cost this manager his job, we cannot afford that to happen to another manager. But unfortunately, as we saw last season, Dundee United did go through a few managers last season, or head coaches.
On a sort of more upbeat note, and you spoke to him, so you'll know if this was genuine. I mean, he called on United to do what I've called on them to do, and go and romp the league next year.
I think that's genuine.
That's good.
And I think at the end of the day, I think Ryan really does care a lot about Dundee. I mean, he stayed in the city for 3 years. He moved up here. He cares a lot about him. He's a bit, as a person, I got to know him quite well at Dundee United, and he's a very, very passionate person about giving 100% to everything he does. He cares about everybody at the club. I mean, I had to leave out a number of quotes, obviously, from a 45-minute interview, but, I mean, he spoke in depth about some of the people.
The book's out in August.
Yeah, yeah. Behind the scenes, I mean, he even mentioned Jenny the cleaner as being the first person he met at Dundee United, and about how he got great respect for the job that she did at Dundee United. He had great respect for everybody at the club. These are the kind of things that people from the outside don't see. They don't see that he's somebody that, as soon as a new person comes to the club, he welcomes them into the club, regardless of whether they're working in the shop or whether they're working as a new teammate. He did welcome the fold. They took all his captain duties in terms of off the pitch very, very seriously, but it didn't work out for him last season on the pitch, and he would probably hold his hands up and say that it didn't work out for him last season. And he also said that he got a feeling quite quickly after Jim Goodwin arrived that he probably wouldn't be a Jim Goodwin signing next season. He wouldn't be a player there in the next season.
Sorry, I'm giggling away at myself. Your Jenny the Cleaner sounds like some sort of mafia nickname, doesn't it? Oh, we need Jenny the Cleaner to sort this one.
That's quite telling. When you're saying when Jim Goodwin arrived, you got a feeling that he wasn't quite the type of Jim Goodwin type player. I mean,
I would have thought he was exactly a Jim Goodwin type, because he was so wholehearted, and you know, he was one that, for all his mistakes, he would put his head in where it hurts.
I think maybe I've worded that slightly wrong. Maybe he realised a couple of games in that he wasn't going to be part of the plans. Yeah. And I suppose when you're first dropped, you initially accept that, you know. But I mean, he did make the point that he continued to be upbeat behind the scenes. He didn't want to sulk behind the scenes because he didn't think that was beneficial to the squad. So I wish him well. I believe he's going to sign for a club in England, and that's probably going to be announced in the next few days. And he's from that area. I know he's got a very young family, and possibly settling back down in the area where he is, I think would probably make a lot of sense, you know. So
it's quite hard to settle down in an area where you're not.
Well, sorry, an area where he's used to. I mean, I think he grew up in the Liverpool area. He's a big Liverpool supporter. I'm not suggesting.
Why they're releasing him then? I say.
I'm not suggesting he's signing for Liverpool, but I would suspect that any club that he signs for is probably going to be within a commutable distance of where he's from originally.
I feel a wee bit for him, because I think he's been the fall guy. I think there was others making as many mistakes as Ryan Edwards, you know, in that team. Even the bringing Loic Aina on loan, who looked a real, real prospect, and I thought he showed some fantastic things. And Alan Temple is a huge fan, but every game or two, he would make a big error that cost them.
In the end, it's not whether he's Jim Goodwin's type. His mistakes were big.
But it was just the malaise had set in right from the goalkeeper, right around the defence, and you know, the lack of a real defensive midfielder as well, I think, cost him not having a Callum Butcher, a John Doe Fuchs type character in there. So, yeah, I feel for Ryan Edwards. I think he's probably taking the biggest hit.
Anyway, moving swiftly on, because Ewan wants to sing Flower of Scotland before we're finished. One word answers. Craig Hinchliffe leaves his post as goalkeeping coach. He's got a job at St Johnstone. Goodbye and good luck.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, to be honest, I read the comments.
How's that a one-word answer?
Right, okay, goodbye and good luck. Well done.
Yes or no? And maybe the bigger news, and I know this because I know the facility well, they've signed up for another 3 years at St Andrews University.
One-word answer, fabulous.
One of the best. Right. We'll move on to our special section 3 just for you, Ewan.
Yeah, is that the end of it? Is it Arbroath? Are we talking about Arbroath?
Now you've mentioned them twice. You managed to go a whole hour without mentioning them. You've mentioned them twice in 2 seconds.
Yeah, I should actually go on one of these sponsors. Not a sponsored silence, but I should actually go around the office
be
get sponsor money to not mention Arbroath in this podcast.
Be silent for a minute so you can speak again.
Okay.
Scotland. Actually, I paid my £15 for that strangely named Scandinavian company that UEFA sold the rights to. Why? That's my one gripe about it. UEFA need to watch this, make it accessible to the public, because it was a great, it was worth my £15 I didn't pay it on Saturday.
I noticed that Wales seem to get their national team on their channel, the Welsh channel, as well as Viaplay, so I don't know what's going on. Maybe there's some sort of deal that Scotland have cut.
But it was an amazing night with the weather, the squeegees, the brushes that were
I heard somebody saying the Ouija's with the squeegees.
Ouija's with the squeegees.
I've seen that.
But yeah. you were there and you were singing in the rain, and quite rightly so.
Yeah,
it was
a
rainy night for Georgia.
Yeah, it was quite entertaining actually. The PA, the DJ was spot on.
Oh, forget the DJ. How good were the team?
Listen, let's talk about the weather first. The DJ's playing.
Let's talk about
the DJ's playing that Travis classic. Why does it always rain? And
yes,
that's absolutely fantastic. That's great humour. And also the other point that you probably didn't pick up on the TV, when the ball boys were all given, and ball boys and ball girls were all given the brushes to sweep the water off the pitch, there was three of them lined up just in front of us in the north stand, and every time they swept something off the pitch, they were getting weighed until they got to the end of it in large cheers, and they were taking applause from the crowd. So there was a bit of banter and humour.
Even the referee's final of his 10 pitch inspections, when he kicked the ball in the net from 20 yards, he must have thought, I've dreamed of this. The whole stadium were up to the winner winning the goal.
It was as big
a cheer for the two goals. It was great.
Every time he kicked it, or he bounced the ball and it bounced properly, he was getting a large cheer as well. The game actually restarted at the time it was supposed to finish as well. So it restarted just after 9:30. I didn't get home until 2:15 in the morning because of traffic and because of waiting. But it was well
Neither
worth it.
Neither did Bairn. He was watching it on the TV in the Perth Road.
Yeah.
I was feeling for all the guys with newspaper deadlines that night.
It did cross my mind while I was watching the game. I was thinking,
there would have been tears in the press box.
Yeah, and back in the desk as well, they would be going crazy because they couldn't get the papers to go out. But do you know what? It's worth every single minute. And I actually turned down to Jackson and I said, Jackson, do you know this game? You'll go to a lot of Scotland games. He's already been to a lot of Scotland games. Probably he'll go to hundreds of Scotland games in his life. And this will be one that you will always remember. You'll go to other games where you'll just forget, I can't remember going to that game. You'll always remember this. So it was well worth it.
Not least because... we're a right good, I'm not saying we're world beaters. I'm not saying we're going to beat Spain in Spain or France or stuff like that. But we're suddenly a right good team. The quality of some of the football. And by the way, if Georgia had a centre forward, I would be very, very worried if I was playing them. If I was any international manager, because technically they were a decent side. But both in Norway on Saturday, when they didn't play well, but they have that air about that good teams have. Mm-hmm. I sensed that when the equaliser went in against Norway, Scotland's first thought was, have we got enough time to win this game? Mm-hmm. And they just had that air about it as well the other night against Georgia, where they're a winning team. And when they pass the ball, they're a good, good team to watch.
I think you feel, the fans feel that. They're going to win games. They're going to beat Georgia at Hampden Park. It's a great place to be. And my admiration for Steve Clarke just grows and grows. I mean, he always...
He's got grumpy, cheerful down an art, hasn't he?
Yeah, he's always been a fantastic tactician, you know, and a very, very shrewd manager. But his biggest asset, I think, is he gets the very best of every player that comes and plays for him. Mm-hmm. You know, they're well drilled on what they have to do, but he seems to be able to raise boys to another level. I mean, I think of boys that don't actually play anymore, the guys like Andy Considine who come in, did a fantastic job. The guy Stephen O'Donnell, who played a few games at right back, did a fantastic, never gets let down by any of these players.
It's a reciprocal thing. He believes in these players. A player I love and I would like to see as a regular starter, but John Souter's hardly kicked the ball.
Yeah.
Georgia, in fairness to them, from 2-0, I was worried even with 10 minutes to go. Yeah. I thought, if they get a goal, this is really squeaky bum time. He puts John Souter, who's hardly kicked a ball all season, on. And John Souter went on and...
Strolled through it.
Partly because the manager believes in him.
I think now as well, I mean, if you look at a good team on the park, you look at the bench. The bench is incredibly strong. You could have played, I think there was 12 subs listed. You could have played 11 of them and they probably could have gone on and beat Georgia as well because of the belief now that is within that squad that he's managed to instill in them. It's no surprise they're doing better. They've got so many players now playing in the top flight of English football. Good players keep the ball, don't give it away. They can't afford to give it away in English football because your team gets punished, so they keep that. And they've got another nucleus of boys who are taking great belief in them, and they're playing in a fantastic manner that's winning games. And yeah, it's all good, good, good. And you're going to the games, you. It must be fantastic.
It's amazing. There's two things I'd like to say about the current group. I've watched Scotland for a long time and gone regularly to games. is the one thing is the bond between the players mm-hmm. and the supporters is stronger than I can ever remember as a Scotland fan.
I know.
I mean, I was summed up a couple of times in the last two games. One was in the Georgia game when we had all the farce and the restart and everything, and Andy Robertson led all the players to go over and applaud the fans, almost to thank the fans for staying and waiting for this game to kick off. I also saw Andy Robertson when he was doing his interview after the Norway game, and the fans were singing "Andy, give us a wave," and he said, "I'm really sorry," stopped the interview and waved to the supporters. They also want to play for the side and they enjoy the humour. I mean,
well, how many years did you get call offs and you know mm-hmm. in the last minutes? Guys just didn't want to come and play international football. Never they bite your hand off to be in that squad. Eh?
Yeah, and they look like they're having fun. I mean, you look. I don't know if you've seen the social media clip of Andy Robertson when he walks off the park after the game, the SFA put out, which I thought was hilarious. He walks off the park, looks at the camera, and he says bedtime, and then just walks off. And then John.
He was hosting a golf day the next morning.
Yeah, John McGinn posted on Twitter when he got home and said, "I'm on the night shift." I mean, it's that Scottish humour that everybody can relate to. It's relatable, but they care passionately about playing for their squad, and it's just a fantastic place to be in.
You get the feeling that, I mean, Steve Clarke, hopefully they will go on there and qualify, you know, for Germany, you get a real belief in that Steve Clarke can finally be the Scottish manager that gets them through the first group stage of one of these European or World Cup, you know, championships.
Yeah.
Sorry, guys, we'll need to stop there because this podcast, some of you are not meant to have anything to speak about. This podcast's gone on longer than the Georgia game did. It's getting dark outside, guys.